Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and iOS 18.5 released to the public a few days ago, but there's even more to talk about since the iOS 18.5 is out what's new video. We'll talk about overall Apple news, some feature updates, as well as the overall experience. I've been using it full-time on the iPhone 16 Pro Max and iPad Pro M4, and I wanted to talk about your experience as well based off the YouTube community poll on the post page. At the time of this video, there's over 13,000 votes and 214 comments. I've gone through all the comments to determine what the overall experience is like for everyone, including battery and more, but be sure to stick around toward the end of the video where I read some of your comments as well. Now there's a new bug in iMessage, it seems, that stops you from telling people about Dave & Buster's, H&M, Tiffany & Co., and others. If you send an audio message using phrases such as Dave & Buster's, it will fail to send. It seems that the and symbol or ampersand is the problem and it's causing odd behavior. So maybe we'll see an iOS 18.5.1 to fix this, as we did 17.5.1 last year, or maybe they'll just wait until iOS 18.6. Apple is ending support for its older HomeKit architecture this fall, according to a newly published Apple document. Apple updated the architecture, and if you haven't hit the update button yet, you'll have to do so before the fall, as iOS 19 and future versions of iOS will no longer support the older version. You can see that here, and I'll link it in the description below. Fortnite was submitted to the App Store and seems to be blocked in the USA now. Originally, Fortnite had said it was blocked worldwide, but Apple said that they only blocked it or continued to block it in the USA due to ongoing litigation, where it seems like it may be available around the world, but until that litigation is finished, it seems like Fortnite won't return to the USA for now. Hopefully something changes there, or let me know your thoughts on that as well, as this seems to be an ongoing saga back and forth between Epic and Apple. Now, Apple Maps this week has been updated with ratings, insights, and expert reviews from people such as Michelin Guide. If we go into Maps, you'll see Apple has updated this already, where we have different things such as the Key Hotel in Brooklyn with the Michelin Guide, and there's expert reviews and more. So those are now available on Apple Maps, along with F1 tracks that are looking to be updated. Apple this week updated Apple Maps with a detailed city experience for Formula One, starting with Monaco. If we go to Monaco, you can see the track outlined in red where they normally race, and we have incredible detail when we zoom in. Use two fingers to tilt the map. Look around, you can see all of the buildings with a lot of detail as we go through. You can see the harbor with boats, as well as down here where the Formula One pit garages are and more. So this is something hopefully we'll see around the world, maybe Miami as they finished that recently, maybe Vegas and other places as they continue to add and update maps. So let me know if this is something that interests you, or what else would you like to see added to Apple Maps. Apple this week also updated Apple CarPlay with CarPlay Ultra. This is the next generation, and they started with Aston Martin. If you order an Aston Martin now, it will take probably 4 months to get one, but you can actually see the new experience. Top Gear did a sort of an overview of it, and Apple posted it on their website. So this is something I took a look at. It looks kind of sterile in the instrument cluster, as I really liked the detailed sort of design that Aston Martins have, but the overall experience in the screen off the center, the normal center screen sort of in the car, looks very similar to what we have with Apple CarPlay, just with additional settings such as climate and more. So let me know what you think of this. Would you buy a car with this? As this is coming to things such as Hyundai, Kia, Genesis, and many others. Apple updated its developer app this week as well in preparation for WWDC 2025. So it's sort of a placeholder for all of the things that'll happen here, along with some stickers that you can get in Messages. So within our stickers and Messages, you can see the new developer app updates, and you'll see them here. So WWDC 2025 with all of the other ones as well. So they do this every year, and we should have that ready for WWDC now. Apple also introduced some new features this week, not just the ones you already know about with iOS 18.5, but in the music app, there's now sound therapy. This has been updated with some new sound therapy where you can keep focus, maybe relax, and you'll see here as well, there's some more for sleep. So that's now available if you want to listen to it. It's available in the music app. Along with this and the new accessibility features coming to iOS 19, Apple introduced two new shortcuts. If we go into the shortcuts app, wait for it to load here, you'll see that we have an Apple Vision Pro Accessibility Assistant, That's for Apple Vision Pro. You can run that and choose a category of conditions, and you can learn more about those. And Apple also added a shortcut called Hold That Thought. This is actually a pretty brilliant shortcut where you can sort of capture what you're doing right now in real time, save it for later. So maybe you had an idea, like for me, for example, if maybe I'm looking through something online, come up with an idea for a video, I could capture what I'm looking at, grab that information, and come back to it later. So they've added that already. If we go to our shortcuts, we've got Hold That Thought, and it says, do you want to capture or recall the last stopping point? So we could capture now, and then it says move to the screen you want to capture a screenshot. This will happen automatically in 5 seconds. So it's a great shortcut, something that's super useful, works on Mac and iPad as well. Now with iOS 18.5, we got about 10 features overall, but there's some more features to talk about with Enterprise. If we go to Enterprise features, Apple publishes this after the release is already out, maybe after a few hours or a day, and you'll see there's a few things here. Emails sent over poor or no network connections will no longer be purged from the device. So that's sort of a bug fix. They also fixed an issue where enabling Apple Intelligence could cause threads in mail to only show the most recent message. They resolved an issue where some supported paper sizes were not displaying as options for printing, and Enterprise apps will no longer fail to launch. Also, the wallpaper MDM command no longer hangs and will not disrupt further communication with affected devices. So all of those things were patched in iOS 18.5. Why they don't just group them into the normal notes, I'm not sure. That would be very helpful, but at this time they're not doing that. There were also a lot of security updates in iOS 18.5, again published after they released it, about 30 different security updates from core audio, core graphics, and more. So definitely worth updating for that, where they fix things such as an attacker with physical access to a device may be able to access a deleted call recording. They fixed this with a logic issue, which was addressed with improved checks. So that's something that's been updated along with many others. One other thing I wanted to mention is tvOS got an update as well. And you can see that here, where the update adds support for synchronizing Dolby Atmos playback to speakers over AirPlay or Bluetooth. And then to use it, it tells you you can go to Settings, Video and Audio, Wireless Audio Sync. So that's something they added in tvOS 18.5. Why they don't just show it on the screen again with notes is hard to say. Hopefully they'll update their notes in future updates though. And with iOS 19, of course, we saw the first features this week with many accessibility features that could be extremely helpful for those that are having hearing issues, maybe deaf, blind, or just maybe have low vision or need a little extra help. I think those were great. I covered them earlier this week. And we also heard from Mark Gurman that iOS 19 will also include AI-based battery management. So that's what I think is called battery intelligence. Maybe Apple was going to include that with iOS 18 and then pushed it off until a little bit later. So what that would mean is maybe it's going to use AI to help you better understand how you're using your phone and then maybe optimize it a little bit better so that you get better battery life throughout the day, telling you not only when it's full, but also when it will drain, maybe how you can better manage your battery. So instead of sort of guessing or just looking at what Apple's help says, maybe we'll have some better guidance there. Also this week, Apple is apparently working on Wi-Fi updates for iOS 19 that will help you synchronize captive Wi-Fi portal logins. Those are things such as airports, hotels, and other public Wi-Fi. So instead of entering them again and again, maybe if you visit a Hilton hotel, the next time you go, it would automatically log you in. Then you could turn on a VPN or something else. Gurman also says that Apple is working on stability this time around. Now, we think we've heard this before, but this time it's coming from Mark Gurman, and hopefully it's true. So this time around, we could finally see some stability updates. At least Apple seems to be aware of it at this point. And speaking of stability, releases this week are showing that maybe there's some issues with stability with older versions. iPadOS 17.7.7 has been having some issues for some people. I heard from one user that installed it, had all sorts of issues, downgraded it, didn't fix it, and still is stuck with issues with Wi-Fi issues, usability issues, and more. And now Apple is no longer signing it. So if you have an iPad and you wanted to install iPadOS 17.7.7, it's not available right now. So that's something where hopefully they'll fix that soon, as that seems very odd that they would pull it that soon. Now, as far as the next version, I know many people are anxious, of course, for iOS 19, but iOS 18.6 Beta 1 could be a ways off. Based on what we had last year, we had iOS 17.5 on May 13th, We had iOS 17.5.1 on May 20th and iOS 17.6 beta 1 on June 17th after WWDC. So we could see maybe a couple weeks until we get maybe a next beta. However, Apple is always changing this up, so it's hard to say. Of course, we know on June 9th, we'll see iOS 19 for the first time, and we expect iOS 19 beta 1. And then, of course, we'll have betas throughout the summer, and then a public release typically in the second or third week of September, right around the iPhone 17 launch. So lots of things to go along with that. And speaking of iPhone 17, iPhone 17 Air is said to be super thin at 5.8 millimeters. I've been using the S25 Edge, which is the same thickness, 5.8 millimeters, and I thought it was going to be goofy at first, but now I actually really like it. It just feels like it's sort of futuristic because a device shouldn't be this thin. So it's hard to explain until you pick one up, and I know a lot of people are going to say that's ridiculous, but it looks like the iPhone 17 Air could get the next generation of battery technology, which means it could charge faster and have much better battery life. And so far on this S25 Edge, I'm actually getting pretty good battery life. About 5 to 6 hours of screen on time. So not too bad considering it's pretty small, but it does have a battery that's larger than the iPhone 16 Pro. So to see something similar, maybe in an iPhone 17 Air, maybe I will use this. We'll have to wait and see. Now, as far as the results for iOS 18.5 and the overall experience, it seems like it's a pretty good improvement for most things. That doesn't mean it's perfect, and it might mean that Apple really needs to fix underlying code in iOS 19, and maybe that's why it's just taking so long. But as far as bug fixes go, I went through all of the comments, compiled all the data, and the number one thing people are saying is fixed is CarPlay. Most people are saying it's working properly, however, it is sometimes still randomly disconnecting for a few people. For example, in one of my cars it works fine, in the other one it doesn't. So I don't know if there's some weird compatibility issue, but definitely an issue there. AirPlay seems to be working fine along with AirDrop and those features, and it fixed that issue, of course, where Apple Watch wouldn't communicate with the iPhone, and that was something in previous updates, but also fixed that message when it's fully charged. But we knew that from the RC. Siri is now working properly for most, and I apologize if that triggered your device as well, and the wallpaper bug does seem to be fixed for most. It's definitely less severe for me anyway, even on vibrant wallpapers. When it comes to bugs, well, the number one issue listed from all of your comments was connectivity with network, whether that's cellular or Wi-Fi. I noticed this a little bit too, where I had to sort of disconnect. It wasn't working properly. I was using Safari. I had to turn off Wi-Fi, turn it back on, and then it worked. At the same time, I had the S25 Edge next to me, and I used it and had no problem at the same time connected to the same Wi-Fi. Also, the next thing people are having issues with is calls dropping. That could be a carrier, as they didn't specify where it was happening. I haven't had it happen with me, but it could be other carriers. And the other thing people mentioned a lot was touch issues. So many people are still experiencing touch issues, and we don't really know if that's because of screen protectors or some other issue, but it's definitely still a thing. Not only touch issues, but unresponsiveness. So why this is happening this time around, we don't really know. Also, people mentioned apps freezing and crashing from time to time. Just going into an app, it would crash. I've seen this multiple places. And one person also said that haptic feedback was missing. And then the final thing is icons or folders sort of displaying bugs or being blurred out or not showing properly. Sometimes that's when you were tinting them, customizing them, they would just look a little weird. Folders wouldn't work properly. And it looks like it's fixed for me, or it's working okay for me, but for whatever reason, it's definitely an issue for some people. Now, overall performance has been pretty great for most people. With the exception of stuttering within CarPlay itself, I've had none on the phone whatsoever. A significant amount of comments actually said they saw clear improvements in smoothness, speed, stability, and responsiveness, with some calling it the best experience they've had with iOS 18. And that's including older devices as well, whether that's an iPhone 11, an iPhone 13, and of course it's not going to be super fast on older devices, unfortunately, as operating systems just get bigger and bigger and use up more storage, use up more RAM, it's going to slow a little bit. But things like ProMotion, people are reporting, seems to be smoother than normal. ramping up to 120 hertz regularly, depending on how you're scrolling and what the list size is, and just opening apps in general seem to be good, such as opening the camera, no real issues. It seems to be pretty stable overall, and it should be at this point in the year. As far as overall heat and thermals, there are a few people that mentioned it's quite warm, but that's typically those that have it processing in the background still after they updated. For the most part, it seems pretty cool on the back, but let me show you with the thermal camera. Now, both iPhone 16 Pro Max devices here are running iOS 18.5's public release. Now we'll take a look here. We're at about 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and I'll place Celsius in the upper right, and you'll see here, again, 84 degrees Fahrenheit, and that's just sitting here doing nothing. This one was in my hand, so it's going to heat up a little bit more, but nothing outside of the normal. It seems to be performing like you would expect with heat and more. When it comes to battery life, many users across various iPhone models, whether it's the iPhone 13 mini, iPhone 16 Pro Max, or any of the phones in between, are experiencing improved or greater battery life, at least according to the comments. 69% of you have actually said that iOS 18.5 was the same or better than iOS 18.4.1. 53% of you said that battery was definitely better, and 30% said that it was worse, but some are still having processes running in the background. So overall, I think it's definitely an improvement that way, and let's see some of your battery life, and then we'll take a look at mine. Now, thanks to Abhishek for sending this in. This is on an iPhone 11 Pro Max with 77% battery health, and it needs a battery replacement. But even on that phone, he's getting 5 hours and 6 minutes of screen on time, using about 90% of the battery. The previous day, 4 hours and 20 minutes, using around 75 to 80% of the battery. So it's decent overall. And my battery life, let's go ahead and take a look. If we go into settings here, we'll go to battery, battery health. I have 100% capacity and 200 cycles. And you can see more details here with coconut battery, but most people are seeing this drop to about 99% after 250 cycles or so. When it comes to battery life, overall, today I had 2 hours and 41 minutes of screen active time at 3 hours of screen idle time and used, well, I'm down to 39%. The day before, 3 hours and 9 minutes, used about 75% of my battery. 2 hours and 31 minutes the day before, and then 4 hours and 20 minutes the day before that. Just depends on what I'm doing. I'm typically getting about 6 hours of screen on time. That's not great for most iPhone 16 Pro Max users, but it's actually pretty good for me compared to 18.4.1 and older. Now, when it comes to benchmarks, I did run them in Geekbench 6. We'll go back here, and you'll see I had some of the best results I've seen in a long time, if not one of the best ever. 3,523 for single core, 8,725 for multi-core. Compared to what we had in the past, it's actually jumped up quite a bit and is one of the best results I've ever seen. So it definitely seems to be much better, and it goes along with it being more fluid and sort of fixing micro stutters and things like that. But definitely one of the better updates here. Now, as far as the overall experience and what you had to say, let's go ahead and take a look at some of your comments. Savile Klassen said, "Great performance, amazing smoothness on my iPhone 11 Pro having iOS 18.5. But the battery is good some here and there throughout today and some days not always. But Aaron, all I want to say is that it still has bugs on this older 2019 model, but it's much nicer." GHZ91 said, "18.5 just saved my battery drain, and it's really good and smooth than 18.4.1 and all of those updates. My battery drain was crazy after 18.4.1, now I got relief. No heating issues as well." MalikJan152 said, "Running iOS 18.5 on my iPhone 16 Pro Max. No issues so far, and definitely a bit smoother than iOS 18.4.1. And has fixed my Apple Music stuttering issue when I would go into the app and it would pause my music out of nowhere and would lock the app. Performance is great, and battery life has improved a bit too." VanceWarren83 said, "It's still having wired CarPlay issues. Once connected, it's fine, but I have to disconnect and reconnect a lot. iPhone 16 Pro, Sony head unit, 250 charge cycles, and my battery is now at 99% health." CBCastillo5681 said, "Feels exactly the same, and there's a bug when you change your icon app colors. Anything you have in a folder will blur out. Pretty annoying." Mr. Austin Felt said, "I'm using iOS 18.5 on my iPhone 13 mini, and it's been great. Battery life is better, and I'm not having any issues." When it comes to iPhone storage, if we go to General and then iPhone storage, scroll to the bottom, you'll see iOS is taking up 18.67 gigabytes. This is a little bit better than iOS 18.4.1 for me, since Apple Intelligence is 6.28 gigabytes. It was a little bit larger, closer to 7 gigabytes or so on the previous version for me. So it does seem like it's getting a little bit more efficient, or maybe I'm just not using enough features to maybe need more downloaded. Either way, it does seem a little bit better this way. So that's everything with iOS 18.5. Of course, we're not going to see as many features going forward as Apple's working on iOS 19. But of course, I'll link this wallpaper in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.